I'm going to start by presenting our outcomes, and then we'll end with a video that's an example of how we do this superior capsule reconstruction. We conducted a prospective study of patients who underwent superior capsule reconstruction using a minimally invasive harvested fascia lata autograft from 2015 to 2016, and we published our results last year in Orthopedic Journal of Sports Medicine. 22 patients were included, and we lost one patient after the 6 months follow-up. We assessed all the results at 6 months and at 2 years. This is important because with these results, you know what to expect from this technique and what to tell to your patients, what to expect at 6 months and at 2 years after this procedure, because they're all evaluated at the same time points. Six of our patients, so 27% of these patients, had previously undergone one or two failed rotator cuff tear repairs, and we confirmed that at final follow-up, 100% of these patients had healed their autografts. 67% of our patients were previously pseudo-paralytic, and 93% reverted. The one patient that did not revert the pseudo-paralysis was one of the two patients who had a graft tear at 6 months. We had MRIs in all patients at 6 months, so 91% of the grafts healed, and we concluded range of motion outcomes and a simple shoulder test, subjective shoulder value, constant scores, that this technique produced good clinical results at 6 months and 2 years. And also, we assessed thigh morbidity at 2 years and concluded that there was a low subjective impact of this harvesting technique at 2 years. We had previously included 15 of these consecutive patients in a simultaneous study directed specifically at the donor site morbidity of our minimally invasive harvesting technique. We evaluated the non-arthritic hip score, cosmesis, and other complaints, and we concluded that at 18 months follow-up, all patients were either satisfied or very satisfied with their donor site. So we concluded that donor site morbidity is not a valid argument to use against using autografts in superior capsule reconstruction, because as you know, worldwide, many surgeons have opted for other grafts like allografts because of the fear of the complications and the donor site morbidity related to mostly the open approach that was described by Professor Mihata in his technique. Also, we have looked at our results now. The last time we did a retrospective study was with patients that had undergone surgery until 29th November 2018. So 38 of these 43 patients who had undergone surgery for irreparable rotator cuff tears had a minimum 6 months follow-up, and the results are really similar with the ones we just discussed and were published for the 2 years results. The results are really good. We recover pseudo-paralytic shoulders. Range of motion, the mean active range of motion was significantly improved in this cohort of patients. You see here pictures of patients who have already 3 years follow-up, and the results seem to be constant. You have a mean functional shoulder course significantly improved, and the abduction strength significantly improved. And also, we continue to have a 91% healing rate of the autograft at a mean follow-up of 15 months. Some of these patients have undergone MRI at 3 years, and they still have the graft healed. In our paper, 82% of the patients that state they would undergo the same procedure again, they are really satisfied. And 100% of the patients that had undergone many procedures for failed rotator cuff repairs said they would undergo this procedure again, because the results are really encouraging. So let's go to the technique. We do this surgery with our patients in the beach chair position. We're going to do a superior capsule reconstruction in the right shoulder, and we perform always the diagnostic arthroscopy prior, because sometimes you have some dubious criteria of irreparability. You have borderline patients, so you have to check during arthroscopy if this is really an irreparable rotator cuff tear or if you can repair it. And one of the main advantages of this procedure is we use a three-portal technique, as you can see here. We introduced a 4-millimeter 30-degree arthroscope in the posterior portal, 2 millimeters medial to the posterolateral corner of the acromion, right underneath the acromion, so that we can have a stadium view of the massive irreparable rotator cuff tear. We point it at the coracoid, and then we perform the second portal, the anterior portal in the rotator interval, and the lateral portal that's oriented under glenohumeral vision. You have to put a needle to check that you have the right angle of approach to the superior glenoid rim, so that if you have to do the superior capsule reconstruction, you can do it through this three portal technique. And as I was saying, sometimes these tears are repairable and you do it through the same approach. And one of the great advantages of this procedure is that you talk to the patient prior and warn them that you may have to do a superior capsule reconstruction, and they always have a fascia lata available for you to harvest. And we do the harvesting, if we confirm that the tear is irreparable, through the minimally invasive approach that you see here. You do a small 2-centimeter incision proximally, 15 centimeters distal to the anterior iliac superior spine, and 4 centimeters anterior to the lateral intermuscular septum. And then you do another incision, 10 centimeters proximal to the lateral femoral condyle, 2 centimeters incision. You harvest the fascia lata, harvest by 3.5 centimeters wide. First, you'll have to implant the glenoid anchors and the humeral medial row anchors. Then you'll have to measure with a probe the intra-articular distances between these anchors and the defects, anterior to posterior and medial to lateral. And we implant two all-suture double-loaded anchors, 1.8 millimeters on the glenoid, and two all-suture double-loaded anchors on the medial row of the humeral head. So then you harvest the fascia lata, as I previously explained. You'll have this usually 17 centimeters long by 3.5 centimeters wide graft. You'll have to fold it 4 to 5 times according to the previous measurements you did with the probe intra-articularly, and you'll achieve a 5 millimeters to 8 millimeters graft. You'll suture it peripherally with a 2.0 reabsorbable suture so that this doesn't delaminate. And then you mark the placement of the glenoid anchors and the humeral anchors on the graft. Because once you have this harvested graft folded 4 to 5 times, peripherally sutured, and the placements marked, you're going to pass all the suture limbs through the graft ex vivo as shown here, and then you're going to take one suture limb of the anterior glenoid anchor and one suture limb from the posterior glenoid anchor, and you're going to tie the double pulley knot so that you can then shuttle the graft intra-articularly, pulling on the corresponding opposing limbs of sutures from the glenoid anchor. And then you'll pass the humeral suture limbs through the remaining rotator cuff, because sometimes you have the possibility to repair the rotator cuff on top of the capsule. And then you'll load all these humeral suture limbs on a knotless lateral anchor, and you'll have two, so you'll have like transosseous equivalent, and then you place these lateral anchors. And we use two knotless push-in pick anchors to do this, 4.5. So, in summary, you'll need two all-suture double-loaded anchors, 1.8 on the superior glenoid rim, two all-suture double-loaded 2.8-millimeter anchors in the transition between the articular cartilage of the humerus and the bone, and then the lateral row with two knotless push-in pick anchors, 4.5, that will load with all the suture limbs you have from the humeral anchor and that you've previously passed in the remaining rotator cuff. So to illustrate this technique, we have this case, this 73-year-old lady, which had undergone rotator cuff repair 1 year before, made by me, which was perfect, and it was in a transosseous equivalent. I was really satisfied with it, but to tell you the truth, I had previously discussed with this patient when she was 72 and she underwent the repair, the possibility of performing the superior capsule reconstruction. She had many irreparability criteria by then. She had a Gutellier 3, fatty infiltration, now it's 4. 1 year later. She had a 3 infraspinatus Gutellier fatty infiltration then, now it's 4. And but she already had a positive tangent sign, which is almost always means it's irreparable, the tear, but I couldn't believe it because we always try to spare our patients more morbidity, and this has morbidity, even though the patients are satisfied. And so I felt that it was mechanically repairable. It was mechanically repairable, but the tendon was thin, and as you see, it failed. And so this is the ideal candidate to undergo superior capsule reconstruction, 1 failed rotator cuff tear repair. And as you can see by this, I left this video like this with the moments where we remove all the sutures so that you have the feeling of what happens in many of these patients. These patients have a biological failure. This was not a mechanical failure. All the sutures are there, all the implants are there. It was the PET 1 tear that became a PET 3 because it didn't heal. And one of the great things of using all suture anchors that's shown in this video is that you see that you almost don't destroy any bone stock. So for the revision surgery, you have all the bone there, and as you will see, we use the same holes. We implant all suture anchors again in the same holes, and they don't pull out. So now we prepare the superior glenoid rim. We have the portals I described through the lateral portal. We prepare the glenoid rim, and then we are going to pass mattress sutures through the remaining rotator cuff tear. So, as this case illustrates, even though this rotator cuff tear is repairable, it doesn't have the biology. I could repair this. You see, you have the coma sign, you can pull the tendon. However, I call your attention to the fact that this patient is in a 70 degree anterior elevation. And as you will see when we start doing the SCR, we're really, the footprint is really far from the rotator cuff. It would be under a great deal of tension if we repair this, and this has failed previously. So we pass 4 mattress sutures to the rotator cuff because we're going to use all these suture limbs in this technique. As you can see, it's not always the same. You don't always have the same configuration of irreparable rotator cuff tears. So sometimes you have to change your technique. The only thing that's constant is the way you do the SCR, but how you put rotator cuff remnants on the SCR depends on the configuration of the tear. So now you have all the sutures in through the rotator cuff. So here we are, the anterior glenoid anchor, 1.8 double loaded suture. Then you put like 1 centimeter posterior to this anterior anchor that you have to prepare, unless it will pull out. You put the other glenoid anchor, so 2 double loaded 1.8 anchors in the glenoid. Now you go to the humeral side and you implant 2 humeral anchors. So now you'll see that I'll extend the shoulder because it's in 70 degrees flexion so that I have the perfect implant attack for the humeral anchor. So this one is the medial row humeral 2.8 double loaded anchor, the anterior one, because this is the right shoulder. And then we're going to put the posterior anchor. Don't forget always to arm these anchors, as you see in this video. Now you implant the posterior one, 1 centimeter posterior to the anterior one. And this will correspond to the markings that you previously saw. So you put the gauge inside, you count 5 millimeters in between each of these laser markings, and you mark your graft that you have harvested and you prepare it. So now we're shuttling it using the double pulley technique. So we're looking from the posterior portal and we're looking at the lateral portal. This is why you need to do the posterior portal 2 centimeters medial to the posterior lateral corner of the acromion, so that you can look at this portal while you shuttle the graft. And you'll notice that I keep tensioning these sutures, because if you don't tension them, they will entangle. And now I'm using the back of these forceps to help the graft go underneath the remnants of the rotator cuff that you have prepared. Now your glenohumeral, we're looking from glenohum, that was the fascia lata. And now we're tying the knots. We tie all the glenoid anchor knots and then all the humeral anchor knots. And then we pass the limbs through the rotator cuff, or otherwise use the limbs that we passed previously, and we load them in this lateral row. This is the pushing anchor loaded with the sutures, and it has some of the limbs of the sutures you saw before passed in mattress fashion in the rotator cuff loaded into these anchors. This one was the anterior one. Now it's the posterior lateral pushing anchor that we're preparing the hole, and then we're going to implant the anchor with all the humeral sutures loaded in. And then we also do some anterior to posterior sutures in this case. We're changing the portal, the viewing portal, to the lateral one. And here you see the rotator cuff on top of the fascia lata. And you have this nice transosseous equivalent with the fascia lata underneath the remnants of the rotator cuff tear. So it's really beautiful, I think. In conclusion, this is a relatively simple technique. You only use 3 portals, and you can use the same approach to repair the rotator cuff repair. You can make an intraoperative decision. You have a high graft availability. In our series, more than half of our patients did not have a long head of the bicep, so this, sometimes in massive repairable rotator cuff tears, you don't have this option as an autograft. Also, you don't have to order an allograft. You always have the fascia lata. You just have to discuss this with your patient. If it's irreparable, we might have to harvest fascia lata. As you saw, we have a low complication rate, no conversion to reverse prosthesis, a higher graft healing rate, and all suture anchors allow us to save bone stock and to avoid distortions on MRI assessments, and also reduce the risk of loose bodies that produce joint damage. If you want to watch the techniques in detail, you can watch a video of our technique of harvesting. It's open access in Orthopedic Journal of Sports Medicine, and so thank you for your attention.